All right, so let's do one. This is our final example of our combined look at chapter 17, 18, 19, right? So energy, momentum, F is equal to ma, rigid bodies. And so I put a problem on the board that looks at using several of those concepts together in the same problem. And so here's the description of the problem. I've got a frictionless surface here, really, really smooth. And I've got a cart C on wheels. And cart C is allowed to move horizontally on this really, really smooth surface. There's also a slender rod that is considered a rigid body that is pinned at the center of cart C at point A and hangs down with a length AB of the entire slender rod. And what we're going to do is we're going to lift it up to a theta angle of 30 degrees. We're going to hold it still. Everything's going to be at rest. And I'm going to let go. And we're going to ask you the question, find simply the speed of cart C horizontally when the vertical rod hangs straight down, theta is equal to 0. Okay? So that's the premise of the entire problem. Now, there's just really one important thing that I got to point out here. Point A is, even though it looks to be sort of fixed and similar to a fixed point in a lot of our other problems, it is clearly not fixed because the cart itself moves. So it may seem like I've drawn it in such a way where point A coincides with the origin of the xy coordinate system to some degree. But it's clearly not fixed because the cart C is going to move. So we cannot treat point A as this fixed point of rotation. Probably not a good idea to use things like IA, for example, and other things related to fixed points of rotation. So how do we go about this? Okay, it's actually a multi-part problem. So I'll let you think about it for a little bit. But first of all, I think the first thing that you will notice is, you know, slender rod hanging from a point you let go. There has to be some gravitational potential energy involved to some degree. So I don't think it would surprise anyone if our first step, if you considered it to be some conservation of energy. Okay, hopefully you can convince yourself of that. There's no friction in the system, no other non-conservative forces, and you're right to start with this conservation of energy, and you would expect it to look something like this. Oops. Should be something like that. And everything's at rest, so this one is zero. And what I like to do is, if everything hangs down, if the slender rod is hanging vertically down, perhaps that's what I consider to be my datum or my reference. Really easy to say this, if maybe there's no potential energy at the end, and that gives you a chance to first figure out potential energies at the beginning. Okay, so that seems like a pretty good start. Okay, no springs, nothing, it's just gravity. And so our V1 is potential energy and the potential energy of just the rod that's hanging at 30 degrees. So you're gonna draw one of these very common diagrams. Here's the length of the rod, LAB. So is this LAB. And what you're interested in is this change in height, right? This is my delta H, right? And so this is my whole LAB all the way down to here. Right? And so clearly our delta H is one of those, you know, 1 minus cosine kind of deals. So I've got my V1. And so clearly it should be MAB times G delta H of the G position. Right? So what it actually is, LAB over 2, 1 minus cosine theta. Okay? So this should make sense. The reason is, and I've drawn this a little bit a little bit misleading here. This is LAB, that's LAB. The delta H that is dropped is actually from point G, right? So I got to make sure that you're aware of me following point G like that. And therefore, the delta H is actually a delta, it's actually an LAB over 2 is your delta H for the G point. Okay, so we're going to calculate that. It's going to give you a 1.97 joules. So that part of the equation completely taken care of. Hopefully that makes sense. And then now we're on to T2. So for T2, here's where that point that I made just now is absolutely critical. Point A is not fixed. If point A is not fixed, we've got rigid body slender rod, and the cart that pretty much serves as just, it's in translation. So you can think of it as a particle. And these two things are working together. So we have to include all of the kinetic energy of all the parts. For the rod, though, because point A is not fixed, we actually don't really know an instantaneous center of zero velocity yet, right? So what is the formula for kinetic energy when you want just general plane motion? The idea is you really want to stick with an IG. An IG is your best bet. You're going to want an IG omega squared for the rotational part. And you want to not forget that if you're going to do general plane motion, let's do an MABVG squared for the translational part of the point G center of mass of the rod. Okay? So I'm going to make a note of this. This is basically because A is not fixed. And we've called this before as the formula for general plane motion when you deal with point G. And here's a perfect case of that, right? Don't use an IO. There's no fixed point O. There's no IC here, right? Okay? Now, that takes care of the rod. Then you take care of the cart. The cart will be my MC. Hopefully I said it was C, yep, MCVC squared. And that takes care of the cart, just moving back and forth. OK, so let's do a quick little inventory of all of our unknowns right now. Our unknowns are omega, VG, VC. Using this conservation of energy equation, I really do need two more equations to make my set of three equations, three unknowns. So how do I get two more equations? Leave that on the board. Right, here's my point G, by the way. So the rod swings down. Whole thing actually shifts perhaps a little bit. So we're gonna need some kinematics. We're going to need some relative motion analysis. And if we want this point VA is the same as my VC of the entire cart. And I want a VG at some point. You're going to have to find a connection between these two. It's got to be something like this. It's got to be. Okay? And that makes sense because now what I'm going to do is I'm going to relate this VC with respect to G. That's got to be this, right? This is my RC with respect to G. We're back to these types of kinematic problems. All right? And so clearly, from a kinematic perspective, we're going to have VC moving. If it moves to the right, it's basically going to be like a VG plus a VC with respect to G, which is like an omega times R. So it's got to be a, right here, minus omega times the R, which is LAB over 2. Okay, so why the minus sign? I put a minus sign in there. It's actually all due to my directions, and you can check them yourself. But let's just prove it even with our cross products. If I say VC is like an unknown value of horizontal velocity in the I direction, I imagine that VG, VG when it's hanging straight down, for instance, would be something like also moving horizontally. But if it's moving horizontally, it's swinging down. My omega is a positive k. So it's kind of like one of these, like an omega positive k cross with an r. And the r is simply my lab over 2 straight up in my diagram. It's a j, right? So if you look at the cross product, the k cross j gives me a negative I. So everything is in the I direction. And you get VC is VG minus omega LAB over 2. So you get a nice little scalar equation. And what does the scalar equation do? It does a few things. It gives us one more equation. And it's linking the three unknowns, the VC, the VG, and the omega. And so we can do a substitution in there and eliminate one more variable. I need one more equation, though. Okay? So that one's a kinematic one. What else is going on in this problem that can give us another equation to work with? And it has to involve the velocity somehow, right? VC, VG, and omega. Okay. Anything else that you can imagine that we've dealt with just very recently in all the sections we've talked about? Right, the thing swings down. Are there any external forces, moments, impulses? All right. So enough hints. Conservation of momentum, right? Oops. So there's a common point at point A where the slender rod is stuck to the cart, but those are just internal forces and they would cancel, but there's nothing external to it that would create an impulse or anything like that. Yeah. Oh, but gravity is that's not considered an impulse in this case, right? Sorry, what do you mean? What's that? How can you ignore that? So you would, the real answer is when you look at the x direction, right? What's happening in your free body diagram for the x direction? No forces, yeah. So basically, I'm saying conservation momentum and apply it to the x direction specifically, right? So I know I didn't really say that, but let's do this, right? You're going to have some internal forces here. They cancel. But the whole system itself is going to have an MCG, and it'll have an MABG. But what else is going on in the x direction? Nothing. Okay. So let's do conservation of momentum. And let me ask this question. If you set up this principle of momentum and impulse x direction, what do you think happens? So what would happen is you set up the principle, and it would be like this. MAB VAB initially in the x, right? So this will be in the x plus MCVC. And VC is only in the x. And the total momentum in the beginning, initially 0. All right, you can look into your impulses in the x direction. There's nothing. And so all you would end up with is an MAB VAB in the x. But when it hangs straight down, VAB, right at the center of mass, is strictly horizontal. And that is the VG that we want to solve, right? That's the VG that we want to solve. And then we're going to add this to MCVC, right? Where VG and VC are the notation that I've used here to signify the point at the end where the rod is hanging straight down. OK? So it is this equation, basically an MABVG is equal to negative MCVC. That serves as our third equation in our set for the three unknowns. And this one right here I can replace right away because I know the masses, right? So let's do that. Let's do VG negative MC over MAB VG negative 5/3. Oops, sorry. OK, so VG is equal to that. I'm going to do one more substitution and get rid of my omega as well. So from the following, VC is equal to VG minus omega LAB over 2. I'm going to get the following omega LAB is equal to VC, VG minus VC times 2. And so omega will be 2 divided by 1. Negative 5/3 VC minus VC eight over 3. Is that right? Yeah. Okay. So those are my substitutions now, which I did in my notes. 5/3 VC, negative 16/3 VC. And I'm going to now plug it all into my energy equation. OK, and so what we have is the following. 1.97 joules of potential energy in the beginning is equal to 1/2. What do we do here? So 1/2 IG. IG is our 1/12 MAB LAB squared. Times omega. Squared. One half MAB. VG squared and then add that finally to the cart, MC VC squared. Okay? So VC squared, I'm going to move everything around and it'll look like this, 1.97. I'll even give you the numbers this time here, so so that's by my calculations, and you would get 0.193. And I'm going to take the square root.
Just for when you calculate the energy caused by the limit of potential, you don't need to
but I told you to do IG, right? So IG was built into the formula, right? So I said general plane motion, use IG omega squared plus the translation part, so no need for parallel axis theorem. Okay, you're not doing it about A, right? Okay, so we got our final result, but I took a square root, and I actually have two numbers, a plus and a minus, and it represents, I think one of them is the right answer for the initial part where the rod swings down. Why did I get two answers, do you think? And which one is correct? Should you put the plus sign or the minus sign as correct? Okay, let's take a quick look. So if I did the following, if I did VC is equal to VG minus omega LAB squared, right? Like I can go back and calculate my omega, but clearly VG from this equation is opposite VC. That's what the minus sign is for. Okay, so I can even look at that and say VG is equal to negative 5/3 VC. So VG is always opposite in direction. So the rod, if it swings down this way, based on my coordinate axis, G is going positive x, right? And therefore, VC is the negative value. Negative 0.44 is the correct answer in this particular case. What does positive 0.44 represent in this particular solution? Is that a valid solution? On the way back, correct. So if the rod, basically there's no friction in the system. So this is a system that oscillates, right? It basically says the rod is going to do this, reaches its lowest point where there's no gravitational potential energy, but it will swing back up. And it will swing back up to exactly theta is equal to 30 degrees. Again, no friction, nothing lost. And then when it goes from this 30 degree angle, the calculation is exactly the same except by the time it reaches theta is equal to 0 again, VG goes to the left, VC goes to the right. And this entire system will just oscillate back and forth forever if there is no friction. So the question is, how do I know VG goes to the left or right? I'm telling you the rod starts at a certain location. And when it hangs straight down, VG was going in the direction that it rotated. Right? Okay? So I do this problem. Hopefully that makes sense. Is everyone okay with that? We combined conservation of energy, conservation of momentum, some kinematics, wrapped up all together in an oscillation type problem. Which brings me now to our final chapter of the course, which is vibrations, okay? Okay, we are so close. You're almost done with me. Okay, so listen, this is this section usually feels very different to most of the students when they take this course, right? They can picture the particle section, kinematics, kinetics, everything fits nicely into boxes. Rigid bodies, they put things into boxes, kinematics, kinetics, and then they jump into vibrations and it's like everything is different, right? Nothing has changed. Everything is the same. All the concepts are the same, and it's got huge applications in mechanical mechanical engineering. Okay, so by the time you get to third year and you're dealing with machines and kinematics and kinetics of machines, more complex ones, you're going to be dealing with vibrations all the time. Okay, so I want you to pay attention. We're going to have questions related to car suspensions and everything else. Okay, but consider this last problem of the swinging rod as your introduction to something that oscillates. Okay? And I want to first lay out for you a map of the sections in this course and what you're in for in the last 6 lectures here. Let me do this. Okay? So hopefully this map helps everybody out, right? The idea is the following. We basically got 2 massive categories of vibrations, right? One category is whether it is free or forced. When I say free, it just means that you let the system go, and you let go of it with your hand, and you let the system do whatever it needs to do. Forced is when you apply something and you apply it over an extended period of time, like you grab the object that's oscillating and you force it to vibrate with a certain frequency. So in these 2 big categories, free and forced, within them, we're going to consider another case, another category, which is within free itself, there will be either damping or no damping. When I say undamped, it basically means frictionless, no friction. Nothing is going to slow it down, exactly like our last problem. If I say damped, damping in my vibration section means friction. So somehow there's friction involved, it slows it down. And we're going to cover 3 out of these 4. And let me just make sure that I got the sections right so you can refer to them in your textbook. This one right here is your 22.1. We're going to do that first, and we're going to do that today. We're going to do 22.3. And then we're going to do 22.4. And this one right here, which is 22.5, we're going to skip. So we're not doing forced damped vibrations, except for maybe 1 overhead slide at the end of the course that I'll show you something regarding that. But you're not responsible for 22.5. Okay, so let's get going here. I'm going to focus right now on free and undamped vibrations. Okay? So here's the situation. I've drawn it horizontally. Let me see if I have a, let's do this, right? So here you go. This is basically what we're dealing with. And I'll do calculations for this vertical mass and spring, right? But, so this is what we're dealing with. Mass and spring system. And you can see right here that this mass right now has a weight hanging straight down of it. It's in equilibrium. And there's a spring force pulling up and an mg going down, right? Now I'll show you something. The spring has a natural relaxed length, like we've always said. That's its natural relaxed length, right? Unstretched. And so when I do something vertically, clearly there's already a stretch to it that keeps it in equilibrium. I'll get to the vertical case by next class, I promise. But for now, I'm going to do it horizontally. So imagine this, where the spring is initially unstretched. And what we're going to do is I'm going to pull it and let go. Okay, when I pull it and let go, it's going to go back and forth and oscillate. And we're going to ask the question, basically, there's a way in which we can figure out the position, the velocity, the acceleration of that mass throughout time. And we know its entire motion, and we want to know the equation for that motion. Okay, so that's this diagram right here. So how do we go about it? What we do is we first set our x is equal to 0 neutral position. Okay, so at x is equal to 0, we call this our neutral position. And for all of these next few lectures, all the equations that we're dealing with very, very small displacements. Okay? So you're going to perturb the mass a little bit to the right. Okay? And you're going to draw a free body diagram. And your free body diagram will look like this. Right? The Fn and the Mg, they balance in the y. The only thing is the kx in the x direction. Okay? Okay? So you're going to do the following. You're going to apply your Fx. And you're going to say, this must be max. And this is going to be equal to my negative kx. Simplest thing you've seen, right? Okay, is my sign correct? It is, right? Positive to the right, I've displaced it to the right, and my force is pulling to the left, and the sign accounts for the direction of the spring already. Everything is cool. Okay, I'm going to change my ax, right? So note that. Another assumption, very small displacements. You're going to, all the masses always, in this section, masses are only translating. Mass only translating. So there's no, let's not worry about a rotation of the mass in this case. Treat like a particle. Okay, so we can treat this particular mass like a particle. Okay, let me do one thing with this ax. This ax is defined as d2x by dt squared. And if I rearrange this, it will then look like the following. Mx double dot plus kx is equal to 0. Okay, so I've used my dot notation now. So have you guys covered this in Math 186? Oops. This is a second order, constant coefficient. Ordinary differential equation. Okay. Okay. That's right. The courses actually do kind of agree with each other, right? We do actually work together on this stuff. Okay. So what do we do? Do we know the solution to that ordinary differential equation? Have we seen that before?
Yeah.
Yeah? What are the solutions to that? Anybody? Sorry? Other than zero, huh? Sines and cosines. Yeah, bingo, right? Right? And I'll just prove the point very quickly, right? If I have a sine theta, let me do sine x, actually. So if I do sine x and I do d by dx as derivative, it becomes cosine x, right? And then if I do derivative of cosine x, we know it becomes a negative sine x, right? Which means if you do two derivatives of sine x, it becomes its same thing with the negative sign, right? So the negative sign pops out when you take something's derivative twice, and it's a trig function, sine and cosine. So here's what happens. I'm going to take my mx double dot, and I'm going to rearrange it, and I'm going to make it look like this. K over m x is equal to 0. Okay, and then let me replace that with something called an omega n. If I define omega n as a square root of k over m, then it's very nice that this omega n squared becomes just k over m, right? That. So that's just the definition of mine. I can actually rewrite this now. X double dot plus omega nx is equal to 0. Right? And you can see very clearly now. In another way, I can write this as negative n squared. I can write this. And so, you know, this is exactly what a differential equation is. If you have an original function and it's an x, like an x of t, so this is x of t, I have an original function x, and what this equation says is, if I take its derivative twice, I get a negative sign. It's exactly the same looking function, and I've got this omega n squared term in front of it. So in fact, my x of t, right, must therefore look like the following. It must be a combination of a sine omega t, b cosine omega n t, with unknown constants a and b until I give you the initial value. Right? So these are initial value problems, right? Okay? Yeah, question.
What is omega here?
What is omega here? Excellent. My next order of business, right? Okay, so everybody with me, right? If I take this x, I'm going to do it two derivatives, add everything up together, it will satisfy this ordinary differential equation. So what's the big deal with omega n? Omega n has a physical meaning. It is described and defined as the natural frequency of this system. So it is the natural frequency of this mass spring system. And let's take a quick look at its units. So the units are square root of k. K is, was it newton per meter? Divided by mass, which is a kilogram. And so newton over kilogram is exactly the same as meter per second squared. So that would be meter per second squared. 1 over meter. Meters cancel. So it looks to me like it is a unit of 1 over second. Okay? So the units of omega n, let me repeat that. It's not 1 over second, it's radians per second, right? Why is it radians per second? Because look at this trigonometric function. Omega n is meant to be a frequency. Right, how frequent something happens, exactly the way that I've defined it. It's a natural frequency. You're going to multiply it by time. So every time a certain amount of time elapses, you go through an entire cycle of an oscillation. This omega nt then becomes a radian, which becomes the argument for your trigonometric function. Okay? So omega n is a radian per second and represents a frequency. Okay, let's do a quick little warm-up example here. So I'm going to do my easy basic problem. And I'll give you some constant values to work with. Okay, so here's what a typical problem will look like with the initial conditions. I give you a mass, I give you a spring constant. That guarantees that you're going to be able to figure out the natural frequency of the system. And then I give you these initial conditions. It's a second order ordinary differential equation, so you're going to need two. You're going to need one for your, well, essentially you need two of any of the three derivatives, right? Or any of the x, x dot, or x double dot. So, but what we have here is x and x dot, okay? And this one here represents a displacement. So if it says negative 0.2, I've compressed the spring by 0.2 meters to the left. And when I say x dot of 0 is 0, at that particular time, initially at rest, no velocity. Okay? So then the question is, what is the question? Find the equation of motion. So find x of t. Give me the entire equation for x of t in the form of the sine and cosine. Okay, so here's what you do. You just do omega n is k over m. 100 over 2. (7.07) radians per second. Okay? So that's your omega n. Therefore, we were always dealing with this, x double dot times the mass. So I can repeat this, but it was basically this equation leading to this, where omega n squared is equal to the 50, right? So that's where I got the 7.07 from. Everything is OK. And then we immediately do the following. We say, well, x of t must then satisfy my general solution, this. OK? Now with known omega n's and unknown a and b. Okay, so here's where we have to find our A and B. So you substitute in your initial conditions or initial values. And the way it works is you say x of 0 is a given. I told you that it must be negative 0.2 meters. And it would be like I took that general solution and I said A sine of omega n times 0, 7.07 times 0, right? Plus B cosine 7.07 times 0. What's the sine of 0? 0. What's the cosine of 0? 1. B times 1. Okay, so we now know what B is, and then we just have to figure out what A is. How do we figure out A? We use the other condition. And the other condition says everything is at rest, so x dot of 0 is equal to 0. X dot is the derivative of that. So So it'll be A, derivative of sine is cosine omega nt, chain rule, so omega n in the front. And then it's cosine. So if I take the derivative of cosine, it becomes negative sine. That. OK? And then the same thing happens. You're going to sub in 0 for these. And the 1 for sine 0 will end up being 0. And so you'll end up with 0 is equal to omega n a times cosine of 0, which is 1. Right? And so it looks to me like a has to be 0. So if a is 0 and b is negative 0.2, our final answer, x of t is equal to negative 0.2 cosine 7.07t units of meters. OK? OK, so one thing is, what should this graph look like graphically? We have to be able to graph these things as sinusoids, right? So I'm going to give you a t-axis. And this would be my x of t. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to do my full one cycle of a cosine function. So there's a 1, 2, 3, 4. Here's my 2 pi. Here's my pi. And my cosine should look like this, right? That's my cosine, generally, where this is my amplitude. Okay? But not good enough. I've got a negative 0.2. So I've got to flip the curve around. The curve is going to look like that. This is my starting point, negative 0.2. This is positive 0.2. That's the amplitude of my oscillation. And this 2 pi here represents one full cycle. But that's not good enough because I want time in seconds, right? So how do I figure out what that time is? That time is related to my frequency right here. When you think about it, the following must be true. If 2 pi represents one full cycle, and it's equal to putting 2 pi into my omega nt, I'm going to define t for one full cycle as my Greek letter tau. And so 2 pi equal to omega n tau means tau as the period is 2 pi omega n. This represents the period of my oscillation. And by my calculations, tau in this case is 2 pi over 7.07 is 0.889. So this point right here is 0.889. OK? Any questions on our new venture into vibrations? Right. Sure. I don't know what you learn in calculus. I know that you guys do differential equations, right? OK? If nothing else, I'll see you guys on Friday.